Hello everybody and welcome back for my continuation of Stephen King's cell book reading. Here we go. Ella shrieks, woke Clay from a confused but not unpleasant dream of being in the bingo tent at the Akron State Fair. In the dream, he was six again. Maybe even younger, but surely not older. And crouched beneath the long table where his mother was seated, looking at a forest of lady legs and smelling sweet sawdust while the caller intoned, B12 players, B12. It's the sunshine vitamin. There was one moment when his subconscious mind tried to integrate the girl's cries into the dream by insisting he was hearing the Saturday noon whistle, but only a moment. Clay had let himself go to sleep on Tom's porch after an hour of watching, because he was convinced that nothing was going to happen out there, at least not tonight. But he must have been equally convinced that Alice wouldn't sleep through, because there was no real confusion once his mind identified her shrieks from what they were, no groping for where he was or what was going on. At one moment, he was a small boy crouching under a bingo table in Ohio. At the next, he was rolling off the comfortable long couch on Tom McCourt's enclosed front porch with the comforter still wrapped around his lower legs. And somewhere in the house, Alice Maxwell howling in a register almost high enough to burst crystal articulated all the horror of a day just passed, insisting with one scream after another that such things surely could not have happened. It must be denied. Clay tried to rid his lower legs of the comforter, and at first it wouldn't let go. He found himself hopping towards the inside door and pulling at it in a kind of panic while he looked out at Salem Street, sure that lights would start going on up and down the block even though he knew the power was out, sure that someone, maybe the gun-owning, gadget-loving Mr. Nickerson from up the street, would come out on his lawn and yell for someone to, for Christ's sake, shut the kid up. "Don't make me come down there," Arnie Nickerson would yell. "Don't make me come down there and shoot her." Or her screams would draw the phone crazies like moths to a bug light. Tom might think they were dead, but Clay believed it no more than he believed in Santa's workshop at the North Pole. But Salem Street, their block of it, anyway, just west of the town center and below the part of MALDEN Town, had called Granada Highlands, remained dark and silent, and without movement. Even the glow of the fire from reverie seemed to have diminished. Clay finally rid himself of the comforter, and went inside and stood at the foot of the stairs, looking up into the blackness. Now he could hear Tom's voice. Not the words, but the tone, low, calm, and soothing. The girl's chilling shrieks began to be broken up by gasps for breath, then by sobs and inarticulate cries that became words. Clay caught one of them. Nightmare. Tom's voice went on and on, telling lies in a reassuring drone. Everything was all right. She would see. Things would look better in the morning. Clay could picture them sitting side by side on the guest room bed, each dressed in a pair of pajamas with TM monograms on their breast pockets. He could have drawn them like that. The idea made him smile. When he was convinced he wasn't going to resume screaming, he went back to the porch, which was a bit chilly, but not uncomfortable. Once he was wrapped up snugly in a comforter, he sat on the couch, surveying what he could see on the street to the left, east of town south, was a business district. He thought he could see the traffic lights marking the entrance into the town square. The other way, which was the way they came, more houses. All of them still in this deep trench of night. "Where are you?" he murmured. "Some of you headed north or west, and still in your right minds, but where did the rest of you go?" No answer from the streets. Well, maybe Tom was right. The cell phones had sent them a message to go crazy at 3, and drop dead at 8. It seemed too good to be true, but he remembered feeling the same way about recordable CDs. Silence from the streets in front of him, silence from the house behind him. After a while, Clay leaned back on the couch. And his eyes closed. He thought he might doze, but doubted he would actually go to sleep again. Eventually, however, he did. And this time, there was no dreams. There were no dreams. Once, shortly before first light, a mongrel dog came up. Tom McCourt, front walk, looked at him. Looked in at him as he lay snoring in his cocoon of comforter and then moved on. It was in no hurry. Picking were rich in Malden that morning and would be for some time to come. Thank you very much. I'm going to stop you here for this book reading part. Thank you very much for listening. Hope you enjoyed it, and I'll catch you in the next episode. Take care. We'll be right back.